Hello and welcome back. If you follow the channel, you already know that my HP 9025, famously used by Mr. Fancy Pants in the HP catalog, died from a power supply failure that caused an overvoltage. The computer died, that is, not Mr. Fancy Pants, fortunately, but the 5 volts became 13 volts, which destroyed many TTL chips throughout the machine. It was our version of the Apollo 13 disaster, with everything broken, but just the custom multi-chip processor still working, which was enough to keep the hope going. Over the 13 previous episodes, we methodically nursed the machine back to life, and finally, it is back to full functionality. In the end, we found no less than 29 fried chips in it. And it wouldn't surprise me if a few more failed in the coming months or years. But we had accomplished much more than saving a rare machine. We had recovered the original schematics, understood how each board works, met with some of the original designers, and interviewed Mr. Fancy Pants, who had spent his whole career at HP and ended up as Keysight's principal metrologist emeritus. But of course, we don't want this power supply failure to happen again. And for that, we are going to design and install an overvoltage protection circuit called a crowbar. Actually, we don't have to design it even, because we are going to copy the one designed by HP. Yes, we are not the first ones with this mishap. HP must have had its share of fried 9025s coming back to the factory for a very expensive repair, and decided to provide a fix of their own. Fellow HP restorer Rick Boss discovered the fix in an HP 9835, the successor to the HP 9825. The 9835 shares the same form factor and uses an almost identical power supply. He sent a photo of the board he found. It's a simple fix, a small add-on board next to the edge connector contacts. But you might ask, what is a crowbar circuit? Could we not simply use a Zener diode to prevent overvoltage? Indeed, many commenters suggested adding a 6-volt Zener across the output to fix the problem. The thinking is that if the output goes too high, the Zener kicks in and clamps the output to 6 volts. But some experienced viewers are probably shouting at the screen right now, because this is not only not going to protect from the overvoltage at all, but it's going to end up in a pretty bad electroboom moment. You see, to use a Zener, you need to feed it with a resistor. The diode works by regulating the current in the circuit so that the voltage drop across the Zener remains at 6 volts, and the resistor takes the rest of the voltage drop. The optimal resistor value for correct regulation is given by the Zener manufacturer, but is typically chosen so that around 10 milliamps flow into the Zener, within a fairly narrow band. This leaves you with a regulated voltage from which you can extract a few milliamps. This is typically used as a reference voltage, or to power a very small circuit. If we omitted the current limit resistor and connected the diode directly to our supply, which is capable of 30 amps, bad things would happen. The typical equivalent circuit of a 6-volt Zener is a 10 ohm resistor in series with a 6-volt voltage source. So let's imagine we fit it with our faulty supply, now at 13 volts, but still capable of 30 amps. The junction of the Zener drops 6 volts, which means that the internal resistor will be dropping 7 volts. At 10 ohms, it means that approximately 700 milliamps will go through it and the junction. Meanwhile, power output voltage has not changed a bit, it will still be at 13 volts, but now robbed of 700 milliamps, so it can only deliver 29.3 amps, which of course will still fry our entire 9025. In addition, the Zener now dissipates 10 watts and will go up in smoke, so that won't work at all. But we are not far from the real solution. We just need to add another component to help the Zener, something that can maintain the output close to 0 volt while sinking the entire 30 amps. And yes, you guessed it, this is called a short. we need to create a temporary short at the output, for example, by putting a real crowbar across the terminals. And that's exactly what our aptly named crowbar circuit does. It creates an electronic short if the voltage goes too high. We are still going to use the Zener, but only to help us detect the overvoltage condition. We are just going to use it to trigger a silicon-controlled rectifier to create our short. The silicon-controlled rectifier, or SCR, is a magical component indeed. Its symbol is like a diode, except it has an extra control electrode. The diode is normally completely off, but as soon as the gate control voltage is above a threshold, on the order of half a volt or a volt, it suddenly behaves like a real diode with but 1 volt across it. Moreover, once triggered, it does not let go, as long as there is positive voltage across the diode. Like a real power diode, it can also tolerate very large currents without destroying itself. The one on the HP board can take 80 amps for a short while. That's enough to sink all of the power supply current and blow the input fuse. At which point, the SCR resets as if nothing had happened and our machine has powered down safely. The crowbar circuit using an SCR is a very old trick. Our IBM 1401 at the Computer History Museum, one of the first transistorized computers from 1958, has solid-state crowbars on all of its power supplies. So if you look at the circuit over here that they have added, this is actually a crowbar. And you can kind of figure it out fairly easily. Here is the SCR. You can read the number of it. It's a 2N4441, which is an early silicon control rectifier. And here are not one but two Zeners, because they want to protect both against an overpower in the 5 volts and in the 12 volts. And here are two additional components, and basically the grounds come here and shorts. Actually, they shorted not on the output of the power supply but on the input. They shorted the 20 volts at the input. Small aside here, both the regulated 5 volts and the 12 volts are derived from the unregulated 20 volts just after the transformer. So they chose to monitor the 5 and the 12 volts output, but put the crowbar further upstream on the unregulated 20 volts to make sure they blow the fuse and not the components in between. And the monitor, one of them is 5 volts and the other one is 12 volts. So basically, if you look at it, reverse engineer it, it's most probably that circuit. You have our SCR, and so I have, there are some modern ones, but it turns out, thanks to the microfiche that were given to me by a viewer, that I actually had a previously unidentified part in my collection, and this is exactly what they use. This is a version of the 2N4441. So I have the exact original part, and what just happened is here you have the two Zeners, and let's take for example the 5 volt one. If this raises above 5.6 volt, the voltage here will start to grow, and when it becomes above the triggering voltage of the SCR, in this case is actually half a volt, it will trigger the SCR, and the SCR will just pull down the 20 volt to ground. It will try to get all the current it can out of the transformer and out of the mains, and it will blow the fuse. I have made a reproduction of the circuit, and while I was at it, I made it exactly the same. So if you look at that, you can see how I made it. And I even reproduced the little HP logo and made it all exactly the same. So off it goes to PCBWay, and hopefully you will get a very good replica of our original circuit. So off to PCBWay we go. (2.2 arcic units × 1 arcic units). And we do 5, 2 layers.
And we are going to do no silk screen. And we're going to do like in the good old days with gold on it. And ba-dum, and ba-dum. And then we just dump our Gerber files in it. And we submit. And a few minutes later, you should have it. And oh, it's going to look exactly like that, like I wanted, with the HP copper silk screen.
1 week later.
And PCB way PCBs have arrived. I'm actually kind of excited to see how they turn out. We always have our PCB way pens, they're all over the lab. And okay. Yeah, my HP logo turned out cool. Alright. You make sure I didn't screw it up in terms of size. Nope, I did not. So that's where this goes. So the other version should be a little bit more modern and have a silk screen. That's the only difference. Actually, this one looks even cooler, I think. Huh.
So here is the modernized version with silk screen. And the more authentic original version with where the only marking is copper traces under the solder mask. Both of them with gold plate. Very nice.
And here's the finished circuit. To make it look as much as I could like the original, I found the resistor with the same color scheme. The capacitors, they make them yellow now. They don't make them teal like they used to. And I couldn't find the Zener diodes with the opaque body, don't make them anymore, but it looks like the real thing, pretty close. And here is a more original one without a silk screen, but frankly it looks almost the same. I'll put this one to 1925 because it looks more original, but if you want to build one, take the one with the silk screen, it's way easier to build. And the question is, does it work? So I've connected it like it's in the HP 1925. It controls the 20 volts and senses the 5 or the 10 or the 12 volts. Here I have connected it to the 5. So if the output goes above 5, it should bring down the 20 volts. So here's my 20 volt supply. And here is my 5, so it should go something above 6. Dang, there you go, just at 6. Then even if that fault goes out, it's an SCR, so it's still clamped. And to reset it, I have to turn it off, turn it on again, and it clamps at 6 volts. Perfect. Excellent. Let's try the 12 volt. So same experiment, I connected it on the 12 volt sense input and I think I have a 13 volt Zener, so it should be out at 13.6. 13, there you go, 13 point something. It protects it. Okay, so the circuit works perfectly. And I have taken the 1925 power supply out and it should fit right in if I haven't messed up anything. Let's see, it was there and voila. There you go. So all you do is you solder it from the bottom and then you should be done. You should have a crowbar protection modification for your machine. And voila, the modification is done, and I was wondering why there was a window here in the PCB, and that's for the cap behind it. If not, it doesn't work, so it's a little too thick, it goes through the PCB. So that explains it now. Alright, so it goes perfect.
Well, that's too funny. In the original picture from Rick's machine, the 9835 supply is different, and it made no sense why there was the square opening. But now that I have it in the 1925, it all makes sense. The cap fits exactly in. Good thing that I made a faithful copy.
And I'm not brave enough to cause an overvoltage on purpose, but we'll check if at least it turns on without tripping the crowbar. And it does. Looks fine. And does it print? Yep. Works fine. It doesn't like the command, but it did print with the 20 volts and all the power supplies on. So it works. Protected now.
So I have now upgraded my four fully repaired HP9825s with the crowbar modification, and I'm happy to report that they are all working fine. So if you are the lucky owner of one of these, I highly recommend that you build your own version and upgrade your machine before you even try to turn it on. I have uploaded the project both on my website and on PCBWay's project website, so you can order it straight from there with one click if you want. I would probably skip the gold plating option though, which adds a huge amount to the cost and is just purely cosmetic. So on this good news, I hope we will see the HP9825s at work in future episodes, and I feel much better now that they are all protected. See you soon!